Alright, this is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you, and today, of all the places in the world where I am, I'm in New Zealand, in Auckland, New Zealand. Totally insane. It was a 12-hour flight just to get here. It's actually a red eye. I got here this morning, and now I'm here. First thing I'm doing today, against my girlfriend's wishes, is making a video for you guys, because this is an important episode that I hope you guys will fully tune into and learn some of the things that I'll be sharing with you guys in this episode. So actually, I guess the story starts is, John, why the heck are you in New Zealand? Well, I want to let you guys know, I travel around the world to show you guys cool gardening stuff and teach you guys whatever I can so that I can empower you guys to grow your own food at home and also be more sustainable on the planet. And when I saw, literally around Thanksgiving time, a fair sale or an airfare come up from the States to New Zealand for $410 round trip, I'm like, I gotta go, because I got a friend that lives here and she's been wanting me to come visit for a while. And so I booked the ticket, and then I remembered in my head, like, John, dude, you gotta check out, like, that there's like a special worm bin. It's like a flow through worm bin design. It's like my favorite worm bin design in the whole world I've ever seen. You gotta visit that company. So I reached out to them, and the owner of the company, he's like, John, I watch your videos. And I'm like, hey, could I come down and film a video about you guys? He's like, yeah, so I'm here. So I got off the plane, he picked me up, and now I'm at his garden, his home, and we're gonna show you guys around his garden, but then more importantly, you're gonna learn about the best designed worm bin that I like that can be used indoors or out, depending on where you guys live, and it could process up to 4 pounds of food a day if you got it totally chugging along, you got it fully populated with worms. The other thing I like about this worm bin that you'll learn about in this episode is that it's really easy to use. It's one of those things that you barely have to do anything because it's basically a self-contained system that'll do mostly everything for you. So they've taken a lot of the labor out of, you know, lifting up trays and sifting it out and making sure the worms stay inside instead of, you know, coming out when you harvest your castings, all this kind of stuff. Anyways, before I get rained on too much, I want to show you guys around. Actually, this front yard, we're just in a residential area. It's kind of crazy. There's like all these beehives in the front yard. So he's helping pollinators as a gardener. Also, he has a few like tamarillo trees and some other stuff. But the real garden is in the backyard. So let's go back and check it out. So now I'm here in the backyard where they got actually 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 raised beds, actually 7 raised beds and a bunch of different plants planted in different containers all around. They got some nice passion fruit and raspberries and all kinds of stuff growing. This is just one of the raised beds. It's been a weird summer season here in New Zealand. And to me, to say like January when I'm visiting is summertime, it's totally whacked out because January, man, that's winter for the northern hemisphere. But this is probably maybe one of the only few times I've ever been to the southern hemisphere where the seasons are flip-flop. So actually that's one of the reasons why I came here to New Zealand, because you know, the winter time, I mean, we've had a nice warm winter actually, but it's supposed to be summertime here where the weather's really nice. And actually right now, just at the organic health food store thing here, they got organic, locally grown organic cherries and peaches, nectarines and plums, all the good summer stuff. So actually that's been pretty cool. That's what I'm gonna eat actually after this episode. But anyways, we got tomatoes still ripening up here. He's got all kinds of different herbs, marjoram and beans and arugulas going to flower, setting seed, kale growing really amazing. And what I really want to talk to you guys about today is not maybe growing vegetables like most of my episodes, but I want to talk about actually some of the things you could actually add to your garden to increase the quality of your crops, but also another, probably one of the most very important things you could add to your garden to increase the fertility of your garden that you guys could all make at home, whether you're a gardener right now or not. I mean, even if you live in an apartment in New York City, what I'm gonna be showing you guys, you know, just in a little bit, is a way that you could turn your food scraps into some of the best fertilizer on the planet. Anyways, first I wanna show you guys a really cool mulching method that I learned about this trip that I wish I could do in my garden year round. All right, guys, so check this out, man. This is one of the coolest mulches I've ever seen, and I would actually probably go so far as to say this is probably one of the best mulches you guys could use, but unfortunately, most of you guys probably won't be able to get it like they're doing here. Anyways, he's got a bed of peppers still coming on. He's gonna start interplanting with like lettuce coming up really soon for the upcoming season, but what he's mulched with here is really cool. We're like, John, what the hell is that, man? Is that like some grass that's kind of dried up? no, this is not standard grass, and I guess people do mulch with grass. This is even better than mulching with standard lawn cutting grass, right? Which I don't know that I'd do, because that would like blow away. This actually has some weight to it. But what this is actually called seagrass, and this is actually a seaweed. I mean, I'm here in New Zealand. There's more shoreline probably than the United States, because this is an island literally in the middle of the ocean, and they have seaweed washing up all the time, and seaweed is one of the best fertilizers you could add to your garden. And the question is, John, why is seaweed a good fertilizer to add? Well, because the seaweed has the different trace minerals that have basically washed off from the land because the land has been eroded. It's washed into the sea, so the sea has all the minerals. The sea can contain up to 90 different trace minerals in the seawaters. And I don't know if the seaweed here is absorbing all that, but surely the seaweed has at least 70 different trace minerals in here. I don't know if they've done an assay on this. But the cool thing is, when you mulch with it, it does a few things. Number one, it covers your soil. Covering your soil is one of the most important things you guys need to do in your garden to protect the fragile microlife and the bacteria and the fungi down below, right? We don't want, you know, uncovered soil. Whether you want to cover it with a mulch, whether it's seaweed or some other material, or I like to actually do a living mulch where I grow purslane below my peppers, so it just fills in the whole area. Then I have a food that's growing that I could eat the purslane, very high in omega-3 fatty acids, and then I'm also having the peppers above. But then also, more importantly, that purslane or the plants are throwing down roots into the soil, which actually feed and encourage more microbial growth. That being said, you know, putting this on top will also feed the microbes, because this stuff will break down, it'll get rained on, it'll leach some of the minerals in there, and over time this is gonna break down literally, or compost in place. This might last a month or two, depending on the weather here. And then pretty much you just come back in a month and this stuff's gone. It's been incorporated into the soil to add to soil fertility. Now, if I just wished I lived somewhere where I could actually harvest this much clean seaweed, you know, over here in New Zealand, not like in the States where there may be all this kind of contamination near the oceans. Anyways, aside from the seaweed that he has on top, we just kind of uncover this a little bit down below. What he just put on is probably the next best thing you guys could be adding to your soil, besides some seaweed on top, or actually even better than the seaweed. This is the worm castings that we'll show you guys actually how he makes in a second. Now, besides the worm castings, you could also, of course, just make standard compost. And what you want to do is we want to return organic matter back in the soil. Now, compost, worm castings, whatever it is, we want to get this organic matter back in the soil. And you're thinking, John, what's better, man? Worm castings or compost? Which one should I do? Well, you know, if you only had to choose one and could only do one, I would say definitely do the worm castings. They're much more, in my opinion, beneficial than a standard compost. That being said, you should do all the different kinds because they all have their own benefits. Like if you have kids and you have two kids and it's hard to say, which kid do you like more, you know? And I would hope my dad would say me instead of my brother, but he can't, he'd never say that. He'd say, oh yeah, I like both my kids, right? and it's kind of like the same. You can't say like which is really better. It just kind of depends on the situation and what you need. Anyways, actually, I'm gonna show you guys the two ways he adds fertility, aside from just this mulch, by making some amazing compost. So the first way he adds fertility to his soil is by making a standard compost pile. Now, you know, every different composting method has its pros and cons. You're basically gonna break down leaves, fallen leaves, you know, trimmings that you've taken off your garden, or food scraps, and you put them in a pile. They basically compost down and turn into a really rich fertilizer to add nutrients to your garden. But more importantly than just the nutrients in the compost, for me, compost is all about adding the life in the compost. So it's like the bacteria. If you're doing a heat-based compost pile like this, it's all about getting some of the bacterial growth and microbes into your garden, because those are the guys that basically break down organic matter and make them available to the plants. And so if you're doing like a pile like this, it could be, you know, a heat-based pile, or you could do like a leaf mold where you just basically let the leaves sit. And this depends on you. Like if you want to sit and fork your compost and fork it over and turn it and flip it and make sure you got your right amount of, you know, browns to greens, carbon to nitrogen ratio, it's going to heat up and it's going to do quite good. But unfortunately, many people that I visit, including maybe here, the compost pile never really gets hot because people are so busy in their lives. They don't have time to sit there, flip their compost, turn it, make sure they got the right ratios of carbon and nitrogen. I mean, I can't even keep a pile like this going because I'm not home enough to flip it and turn it, and I don't want to deal with all that stuff. So actually, I personally use a compost tumbler that I basically put in some compressed wood pellets with my food scraps and along with my plant clippings and dump it in there and then spin it every once in a while. That spinning it aerates it, and I already got the right ratio and it works great. And I'll post a link down below if I remember, if you guys want to learn how to compost in your backyard in a nice compost tumbler that's not exposed, so you may not have any kind of like vermin, rats, or anything invading your compost bin, because I know in some cities you might not want to do that. Plus, depending on how you compost, it may stink. It may stink quite a lot, actually, and I know some people don't like that either, you know. So this is just one of the ways you guys could break down some food waste. But even a better way, especially if you don't have a space for a big pile, you don't want to invest in a compost tumbler, maybe you don't have an outside, you want to do it inside, right? Well, he's got these worm bins, and these are the best worm bins, the best design that I've seen anywhere. So actually, let me go ahead and show you guys that one next. So now I want to show you guys actually one of the best ways you guys could break down your food scraps from your kitchen and turn that into a really rich and delicious soil amendment for your garden. And that's with one of these guys. This is called a hungry bin. They're actually made here in New Zealand, right? These are not made in China like many of the other different worm, you know, bins and whatnot that you could find. Made in New Zealand, designed here as well. The owner of the company actually, Ben, designed this exact contraption to make worm castings and to get food broken down. And he's basically a gardener, and he came from a house that actually had a competitor's worm bin that actually had a tray system, right? The trays get really heavy, you got stuff dripping everywhere, it gets really messy. And he just like, man, you know what? There has to be a better way, because that's like a lot of labor involved with that, man. And you know, I don't know about you, but like, I'm not gonna do something that's super hard. If I gotta like worry about it and all this stuff, I don't have time to deal with my worms every day. So he came up with a system where really there's only a few things you gotta do. All you gotta do is you gotta lift this up on the top, you gotta take your food scraps, you gotta dump it in there, and you gotta close the bin. And I guess when you set up this system, you gotta make sure it's populated properly with worms and set up properly. And then guess what? The worms eat your garbage. Literally, all your food scraps you put in there, fruits and vegetables, even if you wanna put in some, you know, small amounts of meat and bones, or even human poop, we'll talk about that in a little bit. The worms can digest that and turn that into compost. Now, the coolest thing about this design here, if you look at that, number one, this is cool because it's actually on wheels. You could roll it around to where you need it. You know, it has a top, you know, bin here. There's holes in the top so the worms could get enough aeration. But also, this top will keep vermin and pests and other, bugs that shouldn't be in there out, you know. And because this is what's called a flow-through design, you basically put the food on the top, and what happens is the worms will rise up and they're gonna come to the top where there's a nice aeration layer where they could actually breathe, and also where the food is sitting there just waiting for them to eat. And the thing about worms is, you know, they don't like the food you just put in. They like food maybe a few days old, just starting to rot out, but not too rotten. It's kind of like if you make kombucha. You make kombucha when it's too young, it's too much sugar still. You make it and you get it just right where you fermented all the sugar out and it's perfect. That's when I like to drink it, you know. Or if you let the kombucha go too far, then it's vinegar. And the worms are like the same way. Like if the food gets too sour, like vinegar, I mean, they'll eat it, but they don't like to eat it, right? And so you just wanna get and keep the proper level of food up at the top so that they can continue to feast on. And now, at the same time this process is going, you're feeding them every day, you're feeding them a little bit. All those castings that they're making, which is basically they're eating the food in simplistic terms, and they're pooping out nutrient-rich fertilizer for your garden. What happens is all this stuff drops to the bottom. If you guys look at the shape of that, it's kind of like a girl, you know, like a girl has a nice shape, right? No, I'm just kidding. Well, this actually has a nice shape for the worm bin, because what happens is as the castings move down, it kind of goes into a funnel and gets smaller at the bottom. So as the castings move down, they get kind of compressed and compressed, right? And guess what? You know, worms don't like to be, composting worms don't like to be in an area where they're too compressed, like a big Arnold Schwarzenegger dude, like, hug me, oh, no, they're squeezing me. I don't like being compressed. The worms don't like being compressed either, and if they're sitting in the bottom where the soil is getting compressed and compacted, they don't want to be there, so they're going to go somewhere where it's really nice and area and they could spread out, right? And that's up at the top where all the food is. So this system, you don't have to take your bins out, you don't have to shine a bright light on your trays, you don't have to have like worms or things dropping out all over the place on the ground. What happens is all the liquid, or the, I would call it worm pee, will drip out the bottom. So you could take this nutrient-rich solution and just like put it all on your plants, right? And then when you're ready to harvest, which we'll show you guys in a little bit, you basically just take this little piece off on the bottom, and then just a little bit of castings come off the bottom that will basically be pretty much, for the most part, worm-free. Might have a few eggs in there, but the cool thing about this system is, because this is designed where the worms are pretty much sitting at the top, the castings work their way down, and as the castings work their way down, provided that this is a good home environment for the worm eggs will basically hatch inside the unit. The worms then, after they hatch, they'll go up for the food, and the rest of the castings will basically just go down. So you'll have pretty much pure castings. And yeah, maybe some worm eggs will get in there, and that's gonna be really cool. And then you're gonna actually add that to your garden. So then the worms could really live in the place they should be living, which is in your garden that has lots of organic matter, right? One of the challenges with gardens these days is a lot of gardens don't have a lot of organic matter these days. So wherever you decide to keep your worms, you wanna feed them good organic matter. That's why I top off my raised beds with compost after every season, because I have a lot of worms in my garden beds. And for me personally, I'd rather keep worms in my garden beds where they could do the work than like, you know, a compost bin like this. Because now, you know, I put compost in my raised beds. They eat the compost, they poop out the compost or their castings where I need it in the raised beds. And then I basically just make compost with my food scraps. But you could just put your food scraps in here. So it just kind of depends on how you want to do it, right? If you have an apartment and you don't have a garden outside, then hey, do this. Make the compost, give it to your friends, your family, your neighbors, or take it to your community garden down the street, you know, to do it that way. So yeah, I think the next thing I want to do, actually, I want to show you guys how easy it is to harvest some of the castings off the hungry bin. So now I'm about ready to harvest some of actually the worm pee and the worm castings. But before I do, I actually want to show you guys what's going on inside this hungry bin here. We're going to open this up and look at that. All this beautiful rotten food. Now, this is not food for me. I would never in my right mind eat this unless it's the last bin of food on the entire planet. But the worms and the other creatures love it. And I want to talk about that really quick for a second. Worms and other creatures, right? The decomposition cycle on Earth happens with worms and many other creatures. It's not just worms only. So if you open your bin up, like I'm opening it up here, and you see little things like little mites eating the food, or little roly-polies eating the food, or maybe even little maggots or something eating the food, or fruit flies or fungus gnats in here eating the food, that's a good thing because they're all contributing into breaking down the food. Of course, you know, you don't want like to have a fruit fly bin in here. It should be mostly worms with some other creatures kind of like helping along the process. So in here we got like corn husks. I mean, here's some like stone fruit pits. I see some like coffee ground stuff. I think I saw a couple chicken bones in here, you know, citrus, eggshells. Yes, all this stuff can be composted. Oh yeah, let's not forget about shredded paper. Just don't make sure you use any kind of thermal paper. That stuff's nasty stuff. Anyways, if we dig back in here, I want to show you guys this. Look, just like that much underneath, right? This is just all the food fresh. And then underneath here, you don't really see any food anymore. And when I'm digging my hand in there, I wish I could describe the sensation. It's kind of like wet and gooey, and I'm really getting my hands in there. Look at this. Look at all these worms crawling around. They're like all over in here, right? I don't want to make sure they don't drop on the ground. I think I lost a few. But like there's all these different kinds of composting worms in here, and it's the worms that eat your garbage up, right? And so the cool thing about this system is we're going to spread this back over pretty evenly, kind of give them a nice layer so they could actually just live and digest the food, you know. The food basically will get broken down, and then the compost will work their way down because you're constantly putting new stuff on top. And this is the beauty of this system, is that you don't have to rotate any trays, you don't have to do anything except add food on the top and then go to the bottom like I'm gonna do right now to harvest the good stuff that the hungry bin will make for you. So now I wanna show you guys actually the two main outputs that your hungry bin will make for you guys after you only put in one input, which is the food to feed the worms. And what we have here on the bottom is, first you have a nice tray on the bottom. This is included with your hungry bin. You know, a lot of different worm systems don't include this tray. And in this tray, what we have is literally worm pee. So this is a liquid that the worms may pee out. Also, any kind of liquids that have kind of seeped through this whole system with all the different food scraps and various stages of decomposition. But mostly, let's face it, this is mostly just a liquid fertilizer with all the nutrients that were in the fruits and vegetables in a liquid state with some additional bacteria and whatnot. And you know, this would be great to put onto your garden just to add fertility to it. But even though this is cool, this is not as cool as what I'm gonna be harvesting next. And that's out the bottom here. Oh, and the other thing I wanna mention is that there is no tap on this. You know, this is free draining. So, I mean, the top should always be shut because you don't want it just raining in here and leaching out everything. You just want the appropriate amount of moisture in there. And that's why I like the lid on here. The lid will keep the appropriate amount of moisture and any excess moisture will drain out. This is so that you don't have to figure out like, John, what level of moisture do my worms like, right? This system, the way it's set up, because it's gravity fed and there's no spigot on here that you have to open up to drain the extra off, and it's never gonna get too moist in there and kill your worms out. Because you know, if you ever notice, the worms, when it rains, they'll come out onto your driveway, right? They'll make a mess and they don't like when they're flooded out, but this system will drain it out so that you don't have to worry about the moisture level, provided you're feeding a good food source with a proper amount of moisture in there already. So that drains out, and yeah, no spigots or anything to clog up, and that gets nasty. I've had to clean off spigots and worm bins before that have the spigot on the bottom. That's gross. So yeah, so check this out. Easiest way to harvest this. This is the easiest worm castings to harvest I've ever seen. I mean, I hate, you know, sifting out worm castings and dealing with all this stuff. All you gotta do to do this is actually have two hands. If you don't have two hands, get somebody else with one hand if you got one hand. And you're gonna take around, and on the bottom of this, I don't know if you guys can see, but there's these little ingenious clips. There's two clips, right? I don't know if you guys can see that. They're like right here. We're gonna pop it up. And then this is like a double latch system, so we gotta pop it up and then pop it out of the way here. Let's see if I could do that without looking at it right. I pop these guys out of the way, and then what happens is magically, we're gonna basically pull this down. And this is the whole tray right here that you've now harvested. You harvested one whole tray of the worm castings. Actually, this tray is actually quite heavy. This is not like super sopping wet. This is not super dry either. This is probably the right moisture level your castings need to be at, you know. Especially if you guys are buying castings in the store, you definitely want to make sure your castings are not too dry or too wet. Too dry is not too good because there needs to be enough moisture level in the castings for the microbes in there to be living and thriving in an optimal environment. If they're too wet, then there's not enough oxygen in there for all the microbes in there to be living. And so because this is, you know, once again, gravity fed, this is not gonna be too dry or too wet, provided you're feeding, you know, good moist castings in there. Now the cool thing is, this harvested just as much if we look on the bottom here, right? We didn't really get any drips. I mean, you could do this even inside your apartment, your condo, whatever, you know, it's not gonna drip out. And this is the amazing thing is, it gives you just the amount that is ready for you guys to use in your garden. Now, what's really trick is I'm gonna take a camera and actually show you guys underneath there and what it looks like. So now I'm gonna show you guys actually what it looks like underneath where we just harvested from. There's the clip, and this is basically the bottom of the worm bin right here. And now we're gonna go up and underneath to show you guys what it looks like. Look at that, underneath here. This is basically all the castings that are still moist enough that they're being held up. And this is because of the special design, because it comes down as like a funnel. And literally, so the only part that drops down is the part that's ready to be harvested. And the rest is just kind of sticking in there. And that's all right. You don't want to shake this. You don't want to bump it. You don't want to get as many as you can out. You want to just let it be, this makes it a lot easier for the harvesting. And also ensures you're gonna get the properly cured worm castings at just the right stage. So once you harvest all the worm castings out of the little bin here, and while you could just dump these onto your garden, you know, what I prefer to do is actually mix this in with some compost that I made myself, maybe some bag potting soil, maybe some fungal dominated compost, some leaf mold compost, some rock dust, some soil humates that will increase the uptake of some of the nutrients in your garden for your plants, maybe even some kelp powder, kelp meal. Mix that all up, top your beds off with it, and then you gotta replace this bin, which is super simple, super easy. Just put it underneath there like that, shove that underneath like that, and then just this guy clips back in as well. Super simple, and then you're just to take your tray that you've already put out in your garden and just set it right back underneath, and all you gotta do is just keep filling the food scraps up there each and every day. And then depending on how much food scraps you're putting in, because the worms will literally compress a lot of food scraps into a little bit of worm castings, you could be harvesting this like a tray full, maybe like once a month, or maybe even once every 2 months or 3 months, depending on how much you're feeding your guys' worms. So I mean, it's actually the rain's starting to pick up here. I don't wanna get too wet, but what I wanna do next for you guys is actually show you guys some other ways you can use the Hungry Bin, and then maybe we're gonna get to interview the inventor of the Hungry Bin today. Now I'm outside the company of Low Impact, and they are the manufacturers of the Hungry Bin that you guys just saw. And we're outside their warehouse here in Wonhunga or something like that. I don't know the name, and I can't pronounce New Zealand things. But actually this is hungrybin.co.nz for their website for New Zealand. And then actually they are a carbon zero certified organization. The cool thing about this place, unlike many warehouses I've visited, you know, I don't know if you guys can see that, but over in the window, they have like actually, 11 of these Hungry Bins set up that actually is sitting there, and they're using them live, so they got lots of worms in there that are actually digesting the food scraps from some of the banks in the local area. So actually, I want to take you guys inside to show you guys how you guys could be composting with worms inside your house year-round, whether you have an apartment, a condo, or even a business, and talk to you guys more about how to set up a bin and and more about some of the different worms that are used inside it. So now I'm inside Low Impact, and what it is inside here, they have a little showroom where they basically got some of the Hungry Bins set up working behind me, and also they just have a little table with some nice posters behind. A little bit of brochures, but most of this is just a warehouse, but you can come here if you're in New Zealand to check them out and buy them on site. The cool thing about this worm composting bin, unlike other ones that I've seen, that these ones are nice and easy and clean. You know, I've seen other bins that have stacking trays and they kind of get messy even if you have it inside, which you could do. I like this a lot because it actually has a nice big wide tray at the bottom to collect all the worm pee that is coming out of the unit, and I don't see any kind of messes around the bottom of these units. So even if you live in an apartment or condo or want to put this inside your garage, you can easily do that with one of these Hungry Bins. Now I do want to let you guys know is I want you guys, if you guys get one of these or any kind of worm hotel or worm home or worm bin, whether you make it yourself out of wood or out of plastic or whatever, I want you to keep your worms in a good environment. That's very important, right? I don't want you to like have a worm bin and then leave it out in the middle of the desert and, you know, 100 degree weather. Worms do not like 100 degree weather. They also don't like when it's freezing either. The worms like it actually, you could grow citrus trees where you live. That's actually the exact temperature range of worms kind of like. They don't like it super hot and they don't like it freezing. But basically, I'll tell you guys this. The temperature that the worms like the most are the temperatures that we feel comfortable in ourselves, right? If the temperature is comfortable for us, it's gonna be also comfortable for the worm. So please try to set them up in a space outside your house, whether that's underneath the carport, or even if it's in your garden, as long as it doesn't get too hot or too cold, you guys are good to go. And the other thing I like about this bin is, I don't know if you guys can see that, but these guys are on wheels. So some parts of the year when it's maybe warmer outside, you could warm it, you can move it outside provided it doesn't get too hot once again. And if it's getting too cold for them, then you could actually wheel it inside your garage. For me, I probably wouldn't want to move it in and out. I would probably just find one space where it would actually live year round and leave it there. So for me, it actually would be inside my house, because even the garage is not air conditioned in the summertime. It could get too hot for the worms, and I don't want you guys coming home to a whole a Hungry Bin full of literally fried worms because they all dried out because it got too hot. That's definitely not fun. So yeah, take care of them properly. So now I wanna go ahead and show you guys actually the different kinds of worms they're using inside these bins. Normally red wigglers are used pretty much everywhere, but the cool thing I learned about this trip is I learned about more about, because I've heard about them before, about the blue Indian worms. So actually, let's go ahead and open one of these guys up and see if I could point out a blue Indian and a red wiggler and show the guys the difference. So now I want to show the guys the two kind of worms that actually are populating some of these Hungry Bins here in New Zealand. We're going to open this baby up and look at when we lift up the top. Look at that. You see all the worms are actually on the crawling literally on the top of this bin. You know, there's lots of food scraps in here. They're just eating it, and maybe some of them are taking a break going up higher. We're gonna go ahead, give you guys a close up and show you guys a red wiggler and a blue Indian worm. So now we're gonna go ahead and show you guys just some of the food scraps that have been put in here, including just like some paper towels and banana peels. And don't be worried if you see like even mold growing on the top, that's completely normal. Don't freak out. But here I wanna show you guys the difference between the red wigglers and the blue Indian worms. So if you guys look at that little worm right there, right? The one right there, that's actually a blue Indian worm. You can see how dark it is, how like small it is. And if we look over there, that's a standard red wiggler. So the blue Indians, these ones are like more tropical worms. So if you like live in Hawaii or something like that, and you're gonna have your worm bin outside, that's the kind of worm you wanna have. Maybe in South Florida, they kind of like it warm, right? Otherwise, for the most parts of the United States, you're just gonna wanna get the standard red wigglers. You know, each of these worms have their own pros and cons, and you wanna get the one that's actually gonna best be suited to your specific environment and climate. You know, they also have night crawlers, which I do not recommend putting in a worm bin because at night they'll literally crawl away. All right, so let's go ahead and put this bin down and talk to you guys more about composting with worms. So now I want to go ahead and talk to you guys more about the hungry bins here and how to set one up should you end up getting one. I mean, they're super simple, super easy to set up. You can't just open the bin up, put in your worms, close the bin, and then expect it to work. No. You have to make sure you guys have the proper bedding material for the worms. You know, as you see when we open one of these bins up, there, you know, it's pretty much right to the top and that's where all the food goes. So you don't want to just stack the food at the bottom. That's not going to allow the system to work properly. What you need to do is you need to fill it up with about 80 liters of a good free draining compost to start off with. Maybe a good potting soil mixture if you can't get any kind of good free draining compost, but make sure you get a potting soil with some good percentage of something like coconut coir or even peat moss in there. That's gonna be really good for the worms. So you're gonna fill that up, then you're gonna pile in the worms, you know. They recommend you start with about 2,000 worms, which is about 500 grams, or for us Yanks, about 1 pound of worms in there. And then you could start them off with, you know, a fair bit of food. Not too much food, not too little food, just the right amount of food. And you're just gonna let them go to town. The cool thing about the worms is that they could literally digest their weight in food a day. So if you put 1 pound of food in there, that means every day you could basically put in 1 pound of the produce scraps, you know, from your kitchen in there that they'll be able to manage and take care of. Over time, is provided the worms are happy, they're gonna reproduce. They're gonna have little worm sex and they're gonna produce the little worm eggs that are gonna go hatch, and then you're gonna have more and more worms. And then as the worm you know, population increases, you could then slowly increase the amount of food you put in. And this is one of those things you're gonna have to pay attention to, how much food you're putting in and how much is there like maybe the next day. And you don't wanna just keep adding food each and every day no matter what, because if the worms aren't eating it, you don't wanna put too much food scraps in there. It's definitely not gonna be a good thing. Now, I think the next thing that's really important for me to talk about is actually, what are you adding to your worm bin? You know, here in New Zealand, I think one of the coolest things about New Zealand is that they're like on a zero waste approach, right? I mean, they're recycling like cardboard and plastic shrink wrap and all kinds of stuff. And they're trying to be as sustainable as possible. And they're trying to divert as many things as possible from the, you know, the landfill. And this is a really good way to live. Unfortunately, most places in America are not on this kind of path, and they're not recycling nearly as much as they should. I think every municipality should have green waste recycling, mandatory standard recycling of cardboard and plastics and glass and aluminum. And you know, people would try to minimize the amount of waste, and they should charge to cart away your waste. But you know, taking away of recycling and, you know, food scraps and yard waste should be free. Because that would encourage more people to do the right thing. And when you're recycling, whether it's food scraps or yard waste or other recyclables, right, the people collecting those items get money in the back end. They'll make money from processing the food scraps into worm castings or making it into compost or mulch. And so I think this is a much more sustainable way to live. That being said, you know, it's great that the hungry bins can basically just digest all your food scraps, whether you live in an apartment or a condo or have your own garden. That's great, because what most people feed these hungry bins are just standard food scraps. And as good as that is, and as good of a fertilizer that makes, which is great, because basically what's the best plants for other plants? It's plants. So if you're growing fruits and vegetables, what nutrients do fruits and vegetables need? Well, they need the same nutrients that are in the fruits and vegetables that you're now composting down. So we're turning the food and fruit and vegetable scraps into compost or worm castings that now we're gonna feed to other fruits and vegetables so you guys can have a good garden. But now the thing is, this is for extra credit, right? If you guys are into gardening and growing food and you wanna even have better results with the worm castings you're making in the Hungry Bin or any other worm bin system for that matter, is you wanna feed the worms certain food items, right? We are only as healthy as our diet. If I lived, which I don't, lived on a diet of McDonald's or KFC, they actually had KFC here, I was quite impressed. And I'd be like a junk foodist, right? I'd probably be overweight, I'd probably be unhealthy, I'd probably have some issues with my blood pressure, maybe even diabetes and all this kind of stuff, because we are what we eat. You guys know that. But here's the thing, the worms are what they eat as well, and the compost that they're generating is only as good as the food they're eating. So, you know, some places actually just got an email from a guy, one of the owners of the company, they're selling worm castings now at Walmart. Hey, I think it's great that they're selling worm castings at Walmart. It's like a 5-pound bag for $5. That's pretty cheap. And I'm like, great, more worm castings need to be out available for gardeners. If Walmart sells it, so be it. But I emailed the company that makes it, that is sold at Walmart, and I said, hey, what do you feed your worms? And they're like, 100% Michigan peat. So hey, 100% Michigan peat being fed to worms, now making the worm castings, actually turns that Michigan peat into something even more nutritious. But even over above that, that's like eating a mono diet. If you ate nothing but, you know, apple pies for the rest of your life, hey, apple pies taste good, but now you only get the nutrients in those apple pies, right? My diet is varied widely. I mean, just today I got local grown cherries. I had some coconut yogurt from the local health food store here. I got peaches and nectarines and apples and tomatoes, organic, all kinds of different things. So I could have a varied diet because every different nutrient plays a different role so that I could be healthy. And likewise, when you feed your worms certain things, right, you can feed them certain things that are gonna really supercharge your plant growth. I did an interview with George Hahn. He makes the Worm Gold Plus worm castings in California. I'll put a link down below if I remember to that episode. You wanna check that out. Basically how he's able to quadruple some people's harvests, you know, growing pecans and other crops by just adding his specially formulated worm castings. Now, he doesn't disclose his whole entire formula, unfortunately, but since that time, I've figured a few things out. You know, meanwhile, I'll put another link to a video below where I basically took Worm Gold Plus, which is my favorite worm castings, and put half of my bed topped off with Worm Gold Plus. I topped off the other half of my bed with this stuff called Organic Gardening Solution worm castings. And I grew out the same exact plants, the same exact sun, same exact water, and the ones with the OGS worm castings grew even more, it grew like 50% more than the Worm Gold Plus. So that clearly told me, John, there's something in these OGS castings that are really making a growth explosion. It is actually quite interesting. So actually I went down to OGS and filmed a video there where I show all the different ingredients and how they produce their worm castings to give you guys amazing results so that you could buy it from them if you don't want to put it together. Or you guys could actually put it together yourself and feed your worms these special foods along with the food scraps, or actually they're feeding compost, which was basically broken down food scraps and other yard waste materials to their worms. But I'll share with you guys some of the things that you definitely will want to add to your worm castings, which actually it doesn't look like they're really doing here. Number one, you want to add a good cellulose material, right? So shred up clean cardboard, clean newspaper, right? Shred that up, feed it to your worms so they are now eating a lot of cellulose matter. And here's the thing, you know, when the worms eat the cellulose matter, right, then they basically digest the cellulose matter. How can the worms digest the cellulose matter? Well, basically they have enzymes and things in their guts and little creatures, good bacteria in their guts that break down the cellulose matter. So a worm starts eating the cellulose matter, a lot of it, then it's going to have the bacteria in its guts to break it down. Then it's going to actually poop this out into the worm castings. Likewise, besides the cellulose material that you want to feed the worms, you also want to feed them something rich in chitin. That's like the shells, like crab shells, lobster shells, right? Like shrimp shells. Also, like our nails are made out of this chitin material. Now, when you feed the worms the chitin material, right, then the worms will produce chitin aids, which will basically is breaking down the chitin material for the worms so they can digest it, get the nutrients out of it. But now that chitin aids is now in your worm castings that now you're gonna feed to your plants. And this is why, in my opinion, it's said that if you put worm castings on plants, they are more pest resistant, because it's this chitinase that could also help your plants create an immunity and break down the shells of some insects, because their shells are made of the chitin material. Furthermore, also adding things like soil humates to your worm casting or your worm hungry bin, also really good, as well as something like the rock dust, even maybe some biochar, the kelp, which actually they already got in these bins, I think could be quite helpful. And I think those are some of the main things that just off the top of my head I could think of that you guys would want to add to create, you know, an above average casting so you could have, you know, bigger and better growth in your garden. I think I covered most of the things, actually. Another thing I want to talk to you guys about real quick is we're going to go ahead and go into the warehouse next, where they actually have some of the original versions of the hungry bin, because this was the design process they came up with after going through many different revisions until they have the perfected version they have today. So let's go in the warehouse and check it out. So now I'm inside the warehouse here at Hungry Bin. This place is pretty huge. I really love the tall ceilings here, and they got all these like industrial racks like you see at Costco. And right now, actually, they're kind of empty because they had a really good Christmas season here. And I guess things go on holiday around this time of year for them. But what I want to show you guys next is actually the design process. This is always really cool to meet another inventor, somebody that invents things and has gone through and really done their homework to really dial in a product. Because I know, you know, most of us only see the end product and we don't understand what went into making that product happen and how did it come to be. So, I mean, this journey started for Ben like maybe 8 years ago now, and what we're seeing here is like, you know, from about 6 years ago, some of his early bins, and they're not even all here. This is just a good representation of six different models and stages he's been through to try to like get something, refine it a little bit more, make it better, go to the next version, make it to the next version, until they have the end product today. And it's taken a lot of time, money, and capital to invest to get this business to where it is today. And you know, he's still just like all of us, man. He's just living paycheck to paycheck, trying to make his next a rent payment and all this stuff, keeping his business afloat and trying to expand it, and you know, and getting worm castings and making it easy for more people out there. Anyways, I want to actually show you guys actually some of his I'll show you the three early bins and then the three later bins, how they've improved, and actually maybe even how you could make one yourself if you don't want to buy one of these ones. For me, it's just a lot easier to buy something that's pre-made than to try to hassle with it and make something that's almost gonna kind of work. So let's check out where he started. All right, so where he started out with getting these recycling totes, or these wheelie bins as they call them here in New Zealand, getting them for free, because what happened was these units were basically all defective and damaged from the garbage company, so they couldn't no longer use them. So they basically were stockpiled and stored until he said, hey, what are you doing with those? And they basically said, nothing. And he said, hey, can I get some? They said, yes. So he got these and he turned the standard wheelie bins or garbage bins into the hungry bin that you guys see today. Now, these are the early prototypes, right? Some of this is ingenious. He basically just took the bin, and this first one is basically a bin with a second bin that you could actually just lift the top up and flip it down and you could harvest things from. He put a fake bottom in the bottom here with holes drilled in the bottom, and then underneath there, you know, it actually has a little spigot, and this is one of those spigots that could actually jam and clog up and you get really nasty. And then up inside here, if we look, you know, he actually made like a little funnel piece that'll funnel the worm castings down. In addition, you know, he put holes in the top of the bin, and he drilled all these holes in the side of the bin as well. So, I mean, if you have one of these extra bins, hey, you guys could make, you know, a really easy prototype version of what he sells today. And you know, I'm here just to get you excited about composting with worms, whether you're gonna buy one of his bins, which is, they're really nice, or whether you wanna make one yourself. And then moving along, you know, he always tries to improve what he's doing, and I think this is really great. This is the next version he had, and if you guys look at this version, it's kind of interesting. It's actually a little bit larger, and actually this is actually two lids that he actually plastic welded together, which is kind of interesting. And then furthermore, he took this bin and he cut it up, and then he plastic welded it together so to get that nice shape that he wanted instead of just being like a standard bin. Once again, this still has that little door thing that you could open to harvest pretty easily. And it also has the fake bottom, and also instead of having the funnel, this actually just funnels just because of the shape of the bin itself. And of course, on the bottom of this unit, he also has the little spigot. You know, this is when he's kind of getting more serious about it and maybe got some more interest in it. And then he basically went to this version, which is basically he did a lot more plastic welding. He actually made a little frame for it so it sits up in the frame instead of being on wheels. It's now elevated off and it has like that little funnel thing with this little hatch thing that you could actually take off and harvest your castings from. So no longer do you have this little door where you actually gotta scoop the castings out, which is kind of a pain. They'll just basically funnel down and drop down. You can put a tray underneath there to catch all the leachate without any kind of spigot. And once again, this is still just has that standard lid with all the holes in the top. That's where he came from. So this is basically all these three units are just using those standard wheelie bins that were damaged and that could no longer be used for their intended purpose. So I think this is a great use of, you know, bins. But after that, he got more serious about this and he determined that, hey, while this works good, we can make it even better. And that's where the next three, the next two prototypes come in, and then the final unit that he has today. So here's the next prototype he made. Now, instead of using a bin now he's molding his own plastic in here, and he's got latches on the bottom, pretty much like a similar design of today. The lid basically just will come off and fall off easily. It has holes on the top, and this is basically just the design and shape he wanted. And he, I guess at this point, he kind of got like some kind of provisional patent or something like that. And sent these as test units out to the field to get feedback to see how it could be improved. After this, then this wood kind of could rot and is a little bit rickety. They came up with this design here, which basically now has the built-in galvanized frame that will not rust, and it looks more like their current bin today. But there are a few pretty major differences. Number one, this unit is just freestanding. It does not have wheels, so it can't be transported as easy. It still has that tray underneath there, but the tray, you can't easily pull it out. It has some handles on it, so it's not quite as streamlined. This is a little bit wider down in here. This is like maybe a little bit looser. The other thing about this one is that this top latches on four sides. It's actually quite inconvenient to unlatch all four sides. Plus, when you unlatch them all, if I could even do that, the lid just fully comes off, so it could drop and get messy and create a mess everywhere. So, I mean, that wasn't so good. Then they got to the final version today. Now, this is just six of the prototype models. There's a lot more to fill in between here that may be missing in action nowadays. But here's the final unit now. You can see from the original design that we originally had, it's just basically more refined. They've still got, now they got the galvanized rust-free steel. They got the wheels on there. They got a nice little handle like the original ones do. So you could actually you can move it with the handle. This actually latches on one side only, so you could unlatch it, raise it up. It still's got the holes in the top. And this is what it looks like on the inside. It goes into like a nice little funnel with the holes in the bottom where all the castings will sit and wait for you to harvest. Where all the worm pee will actually leak through the bottom. And so now this is a two-piece setup that you assemble yourself. Super simple, super easy. So instead of shipping in a big, huge box this size or the size of one of those totes, it basically can be compressed down to ship in a much more streamlined package that's more efficient for shipping. But yeah, this is the total end product there. I think they've definitely come a long way, and I once again really like the design of this. I think the next part of this episode is, although you guys can use these at home, it'd be great to use inside your house or out. They're also using these in commercial facilities here in New Zealand to process lots of waste. So real quick, I think I wanna go there and show you guys how they're processing lots of waste using the Hungry Bins, and then we're gonna go ahead and get to interview the inventor. So for this last part of this episode, I wanted to share with you guys actually how the Hungry Bins can be used in a commercial environment to dispose of lots of food waste. I'm here now in the Auckland city building, where actually the mayor and the city council is all upstairs or something like that. And down here in the basement, they are taking responsibility for the food waste that's being generated on site, whether that's, you know, somebody coming in and eating a banana and they put the banana peel in the compost bin, or whether that's at the cafes, then they cut off all the food scraps and they basically end up coming down here. And so this is, you know, I think everybody, whether you're a person or whether you're a business, should be responsible for the waste they generate. We always want to send it somewhere else. Have you ever thought about it when you send your waste somewhere else? You know, where does it go? Well, it ends up going into the landfill. That could cause a lot of problems, especially with food waste not properly composting in the landfill, right? In this way, because they're basically processing their food waste on site, number one, they're saving money because now no longer do they have to send that food waste to the landfill that might cost them $300 a week to dispose of all this extra weight of food waste. So they're saving that money. And on the flip side, you know, it's more sustainable, but also, you know, when they put the food waste in here and this whole setup can process, there's 80 of the hungry bins can process 200 pounds a day. So that's mind blowing. So in 5 days, which is a work week, it could process 1,000 pounds of food waste. Now the cool thing is they're saving the money on the front end because now they don't have to send that off to the landfill. But on the back end, they're making the worm castings. The worm castings are a valuable product, and you know, processing 1,000 pounds of the food waste will basically get you approximately half of that amount, or about 500 pounds of the worm castings. Now that could be valued at, like, I don't know, $500 to $1,000, depending on who you ask and the going rate for the worm castings. In addition, you also have the worm pea, which is really nutritious, that you can put on the plants. And the cool thing about this building that I can't get up to today is upstairs they have like a permaculture garden that they use the worm castings and the worm pea for here at the building. So you can't be any more sustainable than this, and I hope that, you know, in the future more businesses, government buildings will take it to the level that they're doing here. So far today you guys learned about how literally one man's journey of being a gardener, wanting to compost his food waste and creating a worm bin, can help you guys out as gardeners, or just help people that want to be more sustainable on the planet by being able to break down their food waste in place, or even by a city building or government building or corporate building that wants to take responsibility for their food waste, but not only just take responsibility for it, actually even create a revenue stream from something that would normally just be thrown away. And that's what many places now in more progressive states like California, where they have the green waste bins, you know, they take them away and then they sell you the compost on the back end. I mean, I did a really cool video at this place called Nature's Way Resources outside Houston, Texas. I'll put a link down below where, you know, we talk about this and how to really value add the products that are available for you to use. And I think this is really, we have to do this for the future. You know, we can't keep filling landfills with all this extra junk. And so I applaud the city of Auckland here that they're actually doing this. And probably one of the coolest things is if you work in this building, you can get as much free worm castings as you guys want. And that'd be really cool. But yeah, I want to encourage you guys to take responsibility for some of the food waste. Like, all 99.5% of the food waste that I generate at my house goes into my bins. That other 0.5 is me and my girlfriend occasionally throw something out, or sometimes if I take something out of the house and I don't bring it back because I'm traveling or something. But yeah, I want you guys to be responsible, especially as gardeners. You could create some of the best fertility to actually put back in your garden. I think the last part of this episode, I actually want to talk with Ben, the inventor and owner of the company that manufactures the Hungry Bin. So now I have the pleasure of introducing Ben Bell, and he's the inventor, designer, creator, and owner of the company that manufactures the Hungry Bin here in New Zealand. You guys got to see his garden earlier. He is a real gardener, I can attest to that. And you know, he did have a need and he filled it. You guys saw an incredible episode today about why I like this Hungry Bin so much. And so we're gonna get to ask him some questions today. So Ben, the first question is, why did you design this Hungry Bin in the first place?
Well, John, it's a really interesting story, but to put it simply, I come from a long line of gardeners. And so our families, from both my grandmother's sides, have really appreciated good quality gardens, good quality compost. It's something I can remember happening, you know, just from when I was a little kid, people were making compost. And so I moved down to the city. My parents were into self-sufficiency, so almost the sort of precursor of organics, and really enjoyed eating quality food. We ate a lot of fresh killed meat from the farm, all that kind of stuff. So I moved to the city and I started putting up a compost bin, and the neighbour put his head over the thing. He said, "What are you doing?" I said, "I'm making a compost bin." He's like, "We don't do that in the city, mate. There's got rats, smell, all that sort of stuff." And I was like, "Wow, okay." And several years after that, a friend of mine introduced me to worm farming, and I had one of those can worms, actually a stackable worm farm, and it worked real great. And eventually I moved in with my girlfriend, so that's a great happy story. And the house I lived in, they owned the worm farm and I owned the worms. So I went down to the hardware store to buy another worm farm, and I was like, man, I am not going to spend this much money on one of these. There's got to be a better way. And being a cynical person, I'm like, oh, I'm going to build a better one. And that was 8 years ago, and that's since then I've got a bit of grey hair going on. So that's the simple
answer. Wow, cool. And then you guys saw some of the different designs, so let's talk about that real quick. Like, how do you figure out all those designs? And if somebody wanted to, could they just make one of your original designs, and would you try to sue them if they want to make worm castings out of just one of those tote bins that they modified?
Yeah. So look, the way I approach all this is all of the different systems work, and they work really well. Some of them have advantages for different systems, different inputs. Some of them may suit some people better. Some may suit different situations better, different size waste streams better, all those different things. So the first thing is I don't try and denigrate anyone else's product. They all work. And I've used a lot of them myself, and I still do actually use a lot of different composting systems myself in my garden and whatever. What I've tried to do with Hungry Bin is to make it really simple and easy to put the food in. And the most important bit to me, although I'm obsessed by worms, I'm actually really keen on the output. So I'm after the liquid and the casting, and I want to put that on my garden, and then I want to grow high quality vegetables that I'm going to eat. And so for me as a designer and a product inventor and someone that's commercializing it, the natural processes are way more robust than industrial processes. So if we can design products that use natural systems and utilize the maximum benefit of natural processes, if we can augment our soil with naturally created fertilizers and grow natural food with the minimum of sprays and minimum of chemicals and minimum of all those other things, we're just taking another step towards A, being more sustainable, because our waste is not going 50 miles away to be processed. We're not running it through a giant industrial plant. We're taking care of our own problem. We're taking care of the waste. We're not expecting the city to pick it up for us and take it away at great expense and do all that. But more importantly to me, we're then in control of the food we're eating, and we've got more engagement with the food that we're eating, because we know exactly what we're putting in a Hungry Bin, we know exactly what we're getting out. And so for some people, it's just enough to put their food waste in. And I've spoken with John a little bit about various additives, and obviously John's an expert at this, various additives you can put in to augment the good compost that the worms are creating, and make sure that there's particular enzymes and bacteria and particular trace nutrients that are important for your garden in your soil. And then once that's there, plants do an amazing job. They want to grow. So if you give them the right conditions, they're just going to grow. They're going to grow amazing fruit, because they want to pass that to the next generation, and we get the benefit by eating it. So that's really the whole philosophy. If we can make something that is simple and easy to use, is very clean and easy and fits with the modern environment, but is producing a very high quality product, which is the worm liquid and the casting, I think we're a long way there. And I think in terms of, we all hear bad news all the time about food waste at the farm. We hear about climate change. We hear about water use to make almonds. I love eating almonds, but every time I get one, I'm like, that's a lot of water that I'm eating. And so we all feel like we want to have some control of our life and do something good. And so I think if we can compost in a way that we're happy with, and we can do it in a way that creates a really high quality fertilizer, and then we grow food with it, wow, we're winning. I think that's where it's at.
Yeah, I think every little bit helps. So Ben, another thing I want to ask is about not just how nutritious the castings are, but what about the worm pea? Some people may call it leachate. I don't know what you want to call it, or you want to explain the benefits of, the liquids that run through the worm bin, because I've heard, sometimes good things about that stuff, and I've sometimes heard bad things. Like sometimes I've heard you shouldn't put that on your plants. And some people say, oh yeah, it's the best fertilizer, right? So what do you say?
Yeah, so I'll start at the beginning. Worms are eating the organic material and they're basically chewing it up, processing it in this incredible gut biota that they've got full of enzymes, bacteria, all kinds of stuff that break the nutrients out and return it to a plant available form. And then they exude basically a vermicast, which is like a sloppy clay looking dark liquid, and you've all seen it in your lawn after a wet morning, or, you know, we all know what vermicast looks like. Now, if you imagine that's a sloppy wet liquid and it gets squeezed, some liquid's going to come out of that, and that's what people will call the worm pea. So you've got two components to it. You've got a solid and you've got a liquid, and it gets squeezed. Now, in a hungry bin, all from the bottom of the bin to the top of the bin is basically pure vermicast, and it's all been processed. And a hungry bin only really works if the top layer is getting broken down and the food's all finished by the time it's gone down, you know, 4 to 6 inches, and it's all completely finished at that point. There shouldn't be any smell after that, and it should be beautiful, beautiful finished vermicast. Now, below that, that's vermicast which is getting squeezed and compressed, and the liquid's getting pushed out, and that drains down through the system and falls into the tray. So in a properly working hungry bin, what you're actually getting is liquid that's either being liberated by the food waste being broken down or being squeezed from the finished vermicast, and it's passing down through the bin and getting saturated with water-soluble nutrients. So at the point it comes out, it's actually saturated with all the goodness. Now the real key here is that plants absorb nutrients in the water-soluble form, or the bacteria that are around the root sheath need it to be in a water-soluble form so they can absorb it, transmute it into something else, and give it off back to the plant. So there's this really interesting symbiosis that goes on between plants and bacteria, and they transfer nutrients back and forwards between each other. Now, if the hungry bin's working really well and it's going okay, the liquid that's coming out is almost pH neutral. It's actually a little bit alkaline. And that is saturated with plant available nutrients, and it's got a lot of plant available nitrogen in it. Now, people will say you need to dilute it down 10 to 1, and I agree with that, is that you need to dilute it down a little because it's just so concentrated. So you wouldn't drink raw cordial, you water it down and you drink
raw
it like
what?
That. Cordial, you know, like
cordial,
a concentrate.
Drink?
No, it's like a juice concentrate.
Oh, so like,
you know,
concentrated
lemonade
juice
concentrate.
In a can or something.
Yeah, so you buy a 10 to 1
so, yeah,
concentrate.
So I'm not used to cordial.
I'm sorry, cordial, English word, I apologize. But essentially, we don't drink a lot of syrups neat.
Yeah.
We dilute them down. And that's because it's easier for us, it's easier for the same for the plants. Now, a lot of people use the word leachate. There's two words we've got to be careful with, is leachate and tea. So leachate is the liquid that comes out of any organic matter or compost or soil that's there, and it'll drain out. Now, if that compost has a rotting component or an anaerobic component, or it's acidic, or it's got a lot of negative bacteria, and absolutely do not put that on your garden unless you've neutralized it back with some lime or something like that, or you've treated it in some way so it's not going to affect your plants. And the same with a hungry bin. If you fill up a hungry bin with so much organic material it rots before the worms get a chance to eat it, that liquid coming out will be absolutely detrimental, and it stinks too, so I wouldn't put that anywhere near your plants. The real key, I think, is that if we accept that all of the material in a hungry bin, I'm just going to turn my phone off, if we accept that all of the material in a hungry bin has been already processed by the time it's exuded from the worm, there's really no chance of anything negative coming out of it, because the whole bin is filled up with very high quality vermicast. If you open up a hungry bin, there's only really a working layer like this, and the rest of it's vermicast. That's not to say that once the worms have finished with it, nothing else happens, because there's lots of enzymes and bacteria and other secondary processes that go on and break it down further and cure it, if you like. So it's in an even better form than when the plants got, you know, when the worm first exuded it. But my thing is, we'll talk about tea in a second, my thing is that if you have all the right inputs coming in and it's all getting processed properly at the top, the outputs will be absolutely perfect for your garden. Now, we do have another little thing with tea where people say, well, you can't take the leachate out or the liquid out of a hungry bin and call that a tea, because a tea needs to be brewed. And so often in what's happening in gardening processes where they're using a tea, and there's lots of different ways of doing it, so I'm generalizing here, but you take a liquid, you put some sort of nutrient in it and you bubble it up, and the bacteria go absolutely crazy. And so one of the ones that people use is molasses. So I'll take some liquid, say from a hungry bin, and they put a mixture of molasses in that, and they dilute it down 10 to 1 or something like that, and they bubble it up for, you know, 4 or 5 days, and it goes crazy, and then they put that on the garden and get spectacular plant growth. Now, my philosophy around that is, first of all, it's quite hard in nature to find molasses, which is a processed sugar, so that's not a, really a natural process. But what's actually happening is the molasses is getting broken down by yeasts, bacteria, and enzymes, and they're basically building up their cell walls and then dying. And you're creating a, you're converting the sugar that was in the molasses back into a protein that is then, or you know, various other elements and all of that. And John knows a lot more about this than me, so I'm going to defer to your expertise around that. But essentially what's happened is you're converting sugar into something that's plant available. And it's the same when we eat sugar in our gut. If we eat a spoonful of sugar, it actually doesn't go straight into our bloodstream as sugar. Our gut converts it into something that, you know, one of the various different glucoses and things, or various different sugars that our body uptakes. So it's not like we just take cane sugar and eat it and it ends up flowing around our veins. Our gut does a lot of work with that. And so that's what people are doing with tea often, is they're augmenting the bacteria that are already there and creating more of them. Or they're using some other product and doing a secondary process where they're processing sugar or some carbohydrate or some feedstock back into more of plant available form. Or the other thing that they're doing is radically changing what came out of here into another form that they might use for pest control. And a really good example of that is, we talked about kombucha earlier. You know, if kombucha's been processed for too long, it goes really bitter and acidic, but that's actually acidic. So then if you spray that on a plant that's got a pest on it that hates acidity, it's going to go, ow! You know, and they're all going to, the aphids are going to take off. And you've put a totally naturally processed pesticide or pest barrier on there that you are comfortable with. So it's not a chemical that's come from a nameless company somewhere in the world that's just making something that you spray on your garden and everything dies that, you know, was once alive. It's something that's come from your kitchen and you've made it. So all of these things, places, have their place in the world. All of these different processes have applications in different forms and you know, different ways. And you may have lots of time to brew compost teas and experiment with that, what's going to work in your particular location and the particular plants you're growing, because some plants respond better to it than others. And or, you know, you may have a philosophical idea about how you want to grow your garden and eat your food and your plants, and you know, that's totally valid. What we hope is that if people want to use worms to create high quality worm cast, is that this is a simple and easy way for as many people as possible to do it. And we tried to create a system that will work perfectly in your house, little balcony on apartment, or as you can see here, in larger numbers, you can just process more food waste. Our real philosophy is the most efficient organism in nature for breaking down organic waste into a plant available form is worms, and we just need to create, you know, the more worms the better. So if we create a perfect home for the worms and feed them nicely, we just get more worms.
Awesome. Yeah, wow, you said so many things that are actually quite valuable in there. Now, I would, you know, concur that this is probably, this is why I'm here today, because I knew about you guys and I looked you up when I knew I was coming to New Zealand, because this is like the most ingenious design I've seen that's just easy and it's really hard to mess up on, right? I wanted to give a 2 cents on worm castings, because I'm going to get back to hard to mess up on. But I wanted to talk about the, you know, worm tea, and you know, some people call anything that drips out of this worm tea. I'd say that's not, you know, worm tea or compost tea. That's when you actually bubble some of the castings with other ingredients, whether that's using molasses or, you know, whole cane, sucanat sugar, or even better yet, some of the research that's coming out is actually kelp or other seaweeds to actually feed the microbes instead of using the fast burn sugars, although that could be helpful too. You know, if you want to get into specifics of compost tea brewing, you could do that. I like to just get the Boogie Brew compost tea. It's a pre-made product, super simple, super easy, and there's a lot of ingredients that goes in there. If I remember, I'll post a link down below to an open source compost tea recipe, so you could actually have a good starting place and experiment. And that's what I encourage you guys to do, right? We want to get some of the worm, you know, pea or the castings in the garden. They're the best things. So if you think about it, you know, in the ground where your garden is, if you have a healthy garden, you're going to have lots of worms in there, and they're going to be digesting and breaking down things where it needs to be. But, you know, a lot of you guys, depending on your climate zone, might not be able to have worms year round. And that's why, you know, supplementing your garden with live worms. And what I want to say is this too, like, if you have a hungry bin and you get overpopulation, pull some out sometimes and add them into your garden, right? And let them thrive in your garden, so you could have worms in the hungry bin, composting and breaking down your food waste in a clean, orderly, neat place. And also you can have the worms in your garden doing the work where they need to be, because, you know, my goal isn't for the world to have hungry bins, although yours might be, and have worms keep sitting in the hungry bins. My goal is to get worms in every garden in the world and flourishing, so we could help repopulate nature, because we are killing it off so fast. So Ben, talking about, like, how can you mess up a hungry bin, because it is pretty much almost foolproof, right?
Oh yeah, but everything has its foible, and everything can be blown up. So that's the first thing. Don't go putting sticks of dynamite in your hungry bin. that'll blow them to bits. If you consistently overfeed a hungry bin, like any worm system, the food will overwhelm the ability of the worms to keep up and eat it. So they like to eat the food when it's soft, but before it's rotten. And we say, in New Zealand, we say 2 and 5, so 2 centimeters per day, no more than 5 uneaten, which is basically about 1 and 3. 1 inch of food per day, every day, you can put on these things. But you don't want to have more than about 3 inches of food in a hungry bin that's uneaten, or any kind of worm farm generally, because what happens is that food breaks together, gets pushed down, and it starts to form a sort of compact layer, and that compact layer starts to rot before they can get into it. And they're just like us, they don't like it when it's rotten. So it's acidic, it's got no oxygen, it's aerobic, which means anaerobic rather, which means there's no oxygen in there. They breathe through their skin, so they can't go and mooch about in rotten food because there's just no oxygen. And so the other thing that happens is when food's rotting and it's anaerobic, the bacterial balance changes, and they just, it's icky, they don't like it, they're just like us. So we say to people, if your hungry bin is starting to smell, that means it's going wrong, and it should not smell at all. And I just, here we are, there's 80 units right here, they're processing food, they've all got food in them, you can't smell it. So if you lift one up and go, whoa, look at this, there's all this food waste in here.
It actually smells like vegetables, like this one smells like
salt. So here you go, look at that.
Because I got like peppers.
You got peppers and lettuce and zucchini in there, you got all sorts.
Lettuce.
And so that's the real key, it shouldn't smell at all. And you know, we've got several large sites in prisons, and we take clients in there and they go, oh my God, I can't even smell it. It looks so, it's like a laboratory in here. And I'm like, yeah, absolutely. Composting doesn't have to be super messy and smelly, and it doesn't have to happen in a giant big stainless steel machine. All of those processes work, and they all have their place. But what we're trying to do is just encourage people to use a really natural breakdown process, and the worms are the best at it, and they're also the fastest. I sort of say to people, like, bacteria do a fantastic job of breaking down food waste and converting it into a plant available form, it's just slower. And the example I use is a zebra on the savanna. Zebra falls over, if it's bacteria, it's going to take weeks and weeks and weeks for it to break down. It'll probably still be a zebra there in months. Hyenas turn up, 2 minutes, they're gone. You know what I mean? And so that's the real key here, is that the worms are very fast, they're very clean, they produce an incredibly high value compost, and they breed like mad. All they want to do is eat and breed, which I'm told, John, is a very boring thing.
Hey, that sounds like a good plan. I like eating and at least trying to breed too.
Yeah.
But next question I have for you is, since we're in a commercial environment where they got 80 of these bins, why couldn't you just invent or, you know, make a super huge hungry bin, so you could have like 2 super huge ones instead of like 80 small ones?
Well, I guess, John, the first answer to that is I'm not Arnold Schwarzenegger, you know, like, I just can't carry a box that big. But the reality of it is that when you've got a certain amount of organic material in one place, it starts to heat up. And so if you're doing a big 3-bay compost and you gather all your ingredients together and you get a cubic yard of it, and you do green, brown, wet, dry, and you get all your ingredients right and get that nice and wet in the right conditions, it heats right up and it'll go to 65 degrees, which must be about 140 Fahrenheit or something like that. Go really hot for even, you know, 2 weeks. And that's really great for breaking down organic matter and getting it, you know, to start that composting process. And those thermophilic hot bacteria do a fantastic job of just breaking down, you know, plant material. And That's no good for the worms because they're like us, they like a temperate environment, so not too hot, not too cold. The hungry bin is just at the right size where it won't start to heat by itself. And so the deal is that it won't heat by itself, and we use cells, so it's sort of like a hive with a honeybee. The worm is the most efficient way of breaking down organic waste. If you want to break down more organic waste, you just get more of them. And if you think about the cells of hungry bins, like the cells in a beehive, if one's going bad, we just leave it alone for a little while and it will settle itself down. And it won't affect all the other ones around it. So we don't lose any production. We just go, oh, this one's just, let's just not feed it for a few days while it calms down. In a big set, if you've got a big contiguous mass of compost and it starts to heat, there's not much you can do about it when that bacterial balance changes over and goes from aerobic to anaerobic, it goes hot. Next thing goes, and all the worms die. And I can tell you from bitter experience, 2 tons of rotting worms smells really, really bad. Now the mayor, he's parked just around there, so we can't have 2 tons of rotting worms here under any circumstances. And so that's where this is really good. The other great thing about hungry bin is you've got a client that's got maybe needs 20 or 40 and you can start them off on 8 and say, okay, we'll start you off on 8. Let's just get your systems going, get everyone comfortable with it, get it working. And then, you know, once you're happy with it, we'll just bring another floor in or another building in and we'll start getting their waste. And then after a little while, we'll go back and say, we did a great job of picking up the waste from the kitchens. Now we want to come back to the living unit or the offices and take all that waste. And then we're going to go and see the barista that's, you know, working downstairs in the cafe, and we're going to get all of the, you know, broken bits of muffin and all of the coffee, you know, from the coffee machine. And that way we can expand the system and use worms that are already existing without having to go to them, well, actually, to do all your waste, we need to get all of it at one go, and you need to spend $350,000 on a giant big machine. And so that's part of it as well with Hungry Bin, is that we tried to make something that's modular, it's scalable, and it's configurable as well. So you don't have to have it all in one place. You can have some here, some over there, some here. And that's one thing we do with a lot of clients as well. You know, schools, for example, they might have 8 here, 8 over here, 8 over here. Big corporate, they might just want to have them all in one place. And you know, when we do work with prisons and hospitals, they definitely want them in one place because they want to put a fence around it. They want to, for their health and safety and their health concerns, they want to say all the composting happens over there, and no one that works in the composting area ever goes in the hospital. It's like, didn't. And so that's another way we can just control the expectation of people that composting, you know, we all know it can be done right at your back door and it's not smelly and messy. But for a corporate, you know, a business like this with 20 floors above us full of workers, it's the last thing that they want to worry about is, oh, we've got some smelly composting process happening in the basement. It needs to be clean, it really needs to be non-smelly, and it needs to be able to be maintained by someone that hasn't got a lot of training either. And that's where the worm farms are really good. You don't have to be an expert to get a really good result. Obviously, if you spend more time experimenting and you spend a lot of time, you know, working with the worms to help them, you know, have the conditions they like, you're going to get a better result. But even if you're pretty casual with them, as long as you don't overfeed them, they'll do what they do and produce high value castings which you can use. So even if you've got an apartment and you're eating out 4 or 5 times a week and you're not making that much food at home, you can still have one of these and the worms will just adjust their population and the lights will go out.
All right, so now we got reset up in another spot where there's still a light. We can't show you guys the hungry bins anymore, but we're still in this massive, like, literally basement parking garage thing. It's like totally huge, and at least the good news is we're not going to get any more background noise from anybody leaving because they're all shut down. But we got a few more questions for you, Ben, before we actually got to go today. So, you know, I know you guys that watch me a lot, you guys know I'm like super cheap, right? I like to get good stuff for the cheapest price possible. And you know, most worm bins in the States anyways, Ben, are like around the $100 mark. So why would somebody want to spend like more money on your bin than maybe like a cheaper worm bin that they could get in the States?
Well, the first thing I'm going to say is it's about productivity, it's about quality, and it's about longevity. So the first one is a hungry bin will process 3 to 5 times what a lot of the other bins will process in the same footprint almost. So it's designed to be incredibly efficient. The second part is we didn't cut any corners when we manufactured this product. It's food grade plastic, it's got organic colorants, it's got a food grade UV package in it, so it is going to last for a very long time. As soon as you handle it, you can see that everything in it is nice and thick, it's really robust. This thing is not going to break. So we've had them out in the real world now for 8 years, and I literally only replaced three or four components several times, and that's it. And you know, we replaced, a woman dropped hers down the stairs and she said, oh, I need to buy this and that. And I said, I'm just gonna send them to you. And she's like, I'll pay for them. And I'm like, no, don't worry. We hardly do any replacements at all. So that's good. Obviously, for a lot of things, you know, the thing I describe to people is, if you buy a brand new BMW in the yard and you drive it out of the yard and smash it into a fence, the guy from the yard doesn't run over with a brand new set of keys and say, I've got another car for you in the yard. So if you don't look after it and you don't look after the worms, yeah, it's not going to work. But they're a lot easier to look after than goldfish, and a lot of people seem to keep goldfish alive. And the really most important part for me is to describe in my own philosophy. So we're making a product that is designed to help improve the environment. And we're not going to get there if we make products that are designed to break down after a year, if they can't replace the parts, if they do need replacing, and at the end of their life if they're not recyclable. So Hungry Bin is all of those things. So it's value for money. We wouldn't sell hundreds of them to prisons and hospitals and large corporates like the Auckland City if it wasn't cost effective. The second thing is, it's very easy to use and it's been designed that way. I've got to be honest, it's because I'm lazy. So I don't like to work hard, and so I just tell people the design of Hungry Bin was motivated by my own laziness. The third part of it is that if we design products that encourage others to engage in this activity and they start doing it, we're all going to start expanding the world of people who are taking care of their own problems in their own backyard. And that's what I'm trying to do. You can't do that if your product doesn't work for people. And so I've gone to a lot of length to try and make sure this product absolutely works. And so, funnily enough, we don't have any price resistance from people once they really understand how it works and what it is. And it's almost like people start talking about, you know, they use words like Rolls Royce or Mercedes. It is definitely the higher end of pricing, but it's going to last for a very long time, and it's going to produce a whole lot more product than, you know, a cheaper one than you get. By all means, start with a smaller, cheaper bin until you can get comfortable with worms. And we say to people, the other smaller units are great starting out, and you might find that's enough for you. But when you're serious, come and talk to us.
Yeah, I would definitely agree that this is a serious unit. I mean, literally, it's built for commercial specifications. They use it here, they use it at prisons and other different commercial businesses, so it really has to put up with abuse. So, I mean, it's literally well made. It's gonna last a long time, not like some of these disposable things from China. I mean, this was designed, as you guys saw earlier, from the ground up to do one specific purpose. It's not like some worm compost tray bin things are basically repurposed from another industry now that's now just happens to now be able to be used to make worm castings. The thing I like the most actually is that I'm lazy too. You know, I'm traveling, I'm doing so much stuff, and as much as I got 12 standard, you know, tumbling composters in my alley, I like the ones I like because they're easy. They're insulated. I don't have to like worry about rotating them. They stay warmer longer. And just like your worm bin, I could just literally add the food and I come back and harvest the castings. And there's no rotating as long as you keep them in a good environment that the worms are going to love. Mm.
So one thing I would add to that is that we actually sell a lot of Hungry Bins to older people. So they're older, they're experienced gardeners, they're very, very good gardeners. They might have been composting all their life using different methods. They know all about it. But none of us are getting any younger, and you know, they might have issues with their back, or they're just not as strong, or they just haven't got as much time, you know, in their garden as they used to have. And so they like the Hungry Bin because it's less labor for them. So they can literally put their food waste in, they take the liquid out that's not too heavy and put it on the garden, and then when they get a visit from a relative, they can get the relative to help them unload the bin. And it's really important because one of the things I think that's really, really interesting is that we've got a whole generation of people, you know, coming towards the end of their working lives and their lives that really do know how to garden. And those people have really valuable experience about what to plant when. You know, we all talk about the old wives or your grandmother's sort of potions and remedies, you know, grandma's remedies for X and Y and Z. But some of those really old things work really well. And they've come from decades and decades and generations of experience. And so we've found it really interesting that we're selling quite a few hungry bins into older people's homes and to rest care facilities, because it provides a way where the clients and the people living there can still do something they've done all their lives, and they can still participate in their gardening, but they don't have to do any heavy lifting or shoveling. And that's, I think, a really important thing as well, that if we can encourage people to be active for longer in their lives, it just means that you have a more fulfilling life, and you can do things that, you know, you might have done your whole life, like grow tomatoes, and you can still do that right up towards the end of your days. And if you get joy from composting, why stop because you suddenly need to shovel it? You can still do it with a worm bin, even if it's a small one, you can still process your waste.
Wow. Oh yeah, and the other thing I wanted to mention about why I like the Hungry Bin, actually, it's made right here in New Zealand, and they're paying a fair wage. That's very important. It's not like some slave labor in China, you know, and I want you guys, once again, buy some good products. So I guess we're coming to the end of this episode. Ben, are there any final comments or words of wisdom you'd like to share with my viewers about gardening, composting, the Hungry Bin, or whatever?
Yeah, look, I just think it's been a really interesting experience for me talking to you, John, to have an expert come down from the US on vacation. So I apologize for taking a little bit of time out of your vacation, but it's really encouraging for us that in the US, we, like New Zealand, we know there's lots of people starting to ask questions and, you know, how can I make a better garden? I really like eating whatever your food is, but I need to know what's in it to feel better about it. You might be worried about things like climate change, or you might be motivated by less waste, or whatever it is. It's really encouraging that people like yourselves are prepared to take the time and help people understand how to meet their own needs, and whether that's more nutritious food, more locally grown food, things that they can participate that they feel make a difference. You know, it's really nice to be able to just be able to continue to tell that story. And that's why we're here as a company. It's about really building a business that is viable and makes a profit, sure, but its really main outcome is a better environmental result for you. You're eating better, being more healthy. For the environment around us, we've got more diversity, we've got better quality soil, and generally we're just spending less money dealing with our problems. We're turning our problems into a solution. You know, I think that's where we're at.
Amazing. I think there needs to be more businesses like your business, Ben, the Hungry Bin, that you make the Hungry Bin, to put out good products to people so that they could be more sustainable on the planet, even grow their own food and use and process the waste that they create on site at their home. So my hat's off to you. It's been really fun hanging out for the day. We literally hung out a day because we have a lot in common, and this guy's a true bona fide gardener, and he really lives his life. I even had some of his kombucha earlier. But
he told me it was too sweet.
Too sweet. It needs to be fermented longer. But anyways, so I've negotiated pretty hard with Ben, and we negotiated for you guys a special discount. If you guys are interested in getting a Hungry Bin, you're not gonna get this discount anywhere else. Be sure to check the link down below. I think it's going to be coupon code GYG for a discount, so you guys could get a better price on the Hungry Bin. Because once you buy one, you're going to be like, how could I even live without it? Because I've done the different bins before, and I mean, this is, once again, the best design I've ever seen. And so yeah, check the links down below. And what is your website here for the people in New Zealand that want to purchase?
Yeah, so it's hungrybin.co.nz for if you're in New Zealand. In the US and Canada, greentools.ca or greentools. I don't think it's .com, it's .ca is the place to go. So search Green Tools Hungry Bin and you'll find it.
Green Tools Hungry Bin. I'll put links down below once again so you guys don't miss that and you guys can learn more. I guess that's pretty much it for this episode. If you guys enjoyed this episode of me hanging out with Ben for the day, learning about the Hungry Bin, please be sure to give it a thumbs up. If I get a lot of thumbs up, maybe I'll do an install of setting up my own Hungry Bin at my place to show you guys more about it and give you guys updates on how my Hungry Bin is going. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on any of my new and upcoming episodes. I've come out about every 3 to 4 days, you never know where or what you'd be learning on my YouTube channel. Also, be sure to share this video with somebody. Maybe it's somebody in the corporate world that wants to deal with their food waste on site, whether it's another gardener or friend of yours or somebody that just doesn't like throwing anything away, they can now process it into the best thing on earth, the worm castings. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,300 episodes at this time teach you guys all aspects on how you guys can grow your own food at home. And be sure to check some of the links down below in the description of some of the videos that I referenced in this episode, which will be quite valuable for you guys. So anyways, with that, my name is John Kohler with GrowingYourGreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.